I'd like to make a public comment. Today, down in Washington, at the White House, Deputy Tortorella, our deputy, was given the Presidential Medal of Valor. So, for a job very well done. About a year ago, over on Eric Road, protecting the children of the school and the people of the town from a gentleman who was, shall we say, out of control. So, good for Joe. He's gotten several awards out of this. He deserves every one of them. We'll go to public input. Brian, do we have anybody who signed up? Good evening, Chris.
Gentlemen, how you doing? Thank you for taking the time to listen, just hear a few of our concerns. This is in regards to the house on Shawnee Road. I've spoken to a few of you, it's, you know, kind of out of your hands and not a big concern. The big concern on my half was the citizens on Shawnee Road that were pretty much not only dragging you guys for the dirt and trying to make you look bad as well as David Holmes, but us as well. I wanted to clear it on record that our intentions were good out there with what we were doing, and we were not trying to cause anything malicious or start any wars over there. We were never approached by anybody from that neighborhood area about what we did. We had a few drills out there. One person came up to us and said, it's nice to see you guys training, you know, this and that. We had a few state classes scheduled through there, firefighter survival and a fast class, and they were set to, one of them already started there, and they were going to be done on June 4th. And like I said, I'm not here to start a war, you know, I just want to make you guys aware that our intentions were good there. We wanted to get all the town of Wheatfield, the fire companies, we spoke of all the chiefs to train all the firefighters in the Wheatfield through there. There's probably about 200 of us total, plus a few other companies in these state classes. So we did have good intentions for that house. We wanted to train, you know, to provide a better service to the community and, you know, taxpayers here. But it was unfortunate that these individuals on Shawnee Road, you know, not only try to make you guys look bad, but they made us look pretty bad too. And, you know, a lot of our guys were not very appreciative of it. It was an unfortunate event of how it happened. I know with David Holmes, you know, you don't want bad business for them. You don't want bad business for you guys either. But how they went about it, you know, two people bullying them and kind of swirled out of control. You know, one of the biggest things was on Facebook. They slammed us pretty hard. And, you know, unfortunately, nowadays, anybody can just get on a computer and say whatever they want to say without knowing what they were saying.
Welcome to politics.
Yeah. I hear you. But I just want to let you guys know, you know, the house was in rough condition. It used to be a member of our fire halls. We had, I can't tell you how many hours we put in with planning through with David Holmes and through ourselves, but we did actually have two or three drills over there. We went there. We cut down trees. We took the grass down. We were in the process of taking the utilities out of the building. I know it was described as an eyesore to a lot of people, and we were cleaning it up, and it was starting to look a lot better, at least viewable. Actually, the person that started this whole process and was bashing us the most actually said, it's starting to look better over there, and that was because of us. I would like just to put it on the floor through the town, you know, however you guys on record, that, you know, that was our intentions out there. We were there to better ourselves, better the other four fire companies in the town of Wheatfield, and the other firefighters that signed up for the state classes there. Like I said, it was unfortunate what happened. But, you know, we didn't really appreciate it, you know, as volunteer firemen taking our time out of our days and, you know, that getting bashed by people who really are uneducated about the events and really had no idea what was going on. And like you said, welcome to politics. But I just wanted to throw that out there, and I wanted to make that clear and well known to everybody that the fire department had nothing. We meant no harm out there. We didn't want to start any problems, but, you know, you know, as the leader of that organization, we didn't appreciate being dragged through the dirt by them out there, and it was unfortunate how it happened.
Well, I think Adams provides an extremely valuable service to the town. We certainly appreciate everything you do. I think your organization on this was helpful. The first I heard of it was when you sent me the email Wednesday or Thursday, whatever day last week the email was. I did talk to Mike about it. Mike had already made decisions with the owner, and those decisions had already been put into action.
Yep.
So it's not likely that you're going to be able to proceed with that particular home.
Mm-hmm.
Mike does say there's a couple of other homes that were in town. Unless things have changed, Mike, that there were a couple of other homes in town that you might be able to do the same kind of procedure with and still get the training in that you're seeking to do.
Yeah, and you guys as the, you know, representatives of town and Mike himself, you've been, you know, great with helping with us, with this process the last few days of this unfortunate event, as I said. In the future...
I understand, it's private property, we don't control it.
Oh, sorry, I didn't mean that. All I would ask is, you know, on behalf maybe, you know, if this other does happen in the future for us or other fire companies in the town of Wheatfield, that, you know, I've never seen anything like this come of this, you know. I think we've, since I've been a fireman, Adams, we've acquired 3 or 4 structures, never had a problem. I know St. John's here, Burkle's, Frontier and Shawnee, same thing, never had a problem. I don't know if this is the one in a million thing or what, but, you know, we try to, we're not out there to make anybody's life miserable out there, you know. We're just out there to better ourselves and better the community. But if we can somehow do something in the future to make it more smoothly, I don't know if we can work together a little better, you know, for heads up or however, but...
Maybe this is a good second. Are we still where we were on Thursday, Mike? So the owner of the property's intention is to get that done and get it down? Start with my house, would you? Take it right to the ground. Okay, thank you, Chris.
Yes, thank you for hearing me, guys.
Okay, Brian?
Sorry. Good evening, everybody. Well, I just wanted to say, gosh, it was great to hear great good news from Judge Caruso. Don't you all agree?
Absolutely.
And from the bottom of my heart, I'm grateful for all the work that the citizens did to educate you and the public so that we were able to get the momentum to get everything done and to ultimately have a positive decision from Judge Caruso. So with that said, I know that there's a possibility that this can keep going on and being appealed. So I wanted to find out, when I read the decision, it's my understanding that they have 30 days to appeal the decision. Is that correct?
They have 30 days from what's called receiving notice of entry, which is something that's sent to them. They would have had it. I know it's been sent out. So not necessarily exactly 30 days of, you know, from what the date on the paperwork, but when they receive it.
And then Ag and Markets is another player in this.
Really?
And I'm wondering, first of all, if you've received anything new from Ag and Markets. I know that we had sent a letter. We've sent several letters, and we haven't gotten any response. So I'm wondering what that is, and then what the protocol will be for notifying us so that we need to find out if we need to get the band back together to fight this further if they decide to appeal. So what will the notification process be?
You know that we're going to let you know, right? That's pretty obvious if something happens. You certainly can ask a question anytime you wish and get an answer, you or anybody. We don't anticipate anything from Ag and Markets. I don't know if we anticipate an appeal or not. That's yet to be decided, but probably not much to be appealed.
Well, on that front, I mean, and your other question with Ag and Markets, we have not heard anything. We've had mailings back and forth. We've had a phone conference with Steve Ricca, and we've discussed it to see what they're going to position they might take. We have not heard anything. It's very hard to say how this court decision may influence them, if it will inspire them to not do anything or to step up an effort or to make an opinion either in favor or contrary. We just don't know. We haven't heard a peep out of them. With regard to the decision, there is a possibility of appeal. I think, and we've sort of discussed this, supervisor and the attorneys involved with this is sort of a monumental decision. It will carry a lot of weight across the state, so anytime you have a decision like that, there's always a possibility of appeal. That being said, the decision was very favorable, and I think we have to commend Judge Caruso. It did take him a long time, but he went through very methodically, and every point that was addressed, he looked at very closely and came up with a very well-reasoned decision. So I would think that certainly is in the town's favor. But we do have 30 days to appeal. We haven't heard anything, but certainly.
Why did you say you didn't think that there was going to be an appeal, or did I misunderstand you just a minute ago?
I think supervisor said that. I said that.
Why do you? Can you elaborate or not in this forum?
There's nothing to elaborate other than reading the decision itself, point by point by point. I don't see anything where they have much chance of winning an appeal. They basically had no standing, and that's the position that the judge took.
Okay.
And I agree. That's a pretty powerful point, even before you get into some of the arguments.
Right.
That if they don't have standing, then it's really not.
Right.
There's an issue there that you can get past square one. So
how long do you think, if we don't hear from Ag and Markets, that we can feel like, ah, we're all like, please, what do you think here? It'd be nice to be done.
Obviously, we have no answer for that. The other part that's nice to know is that for over 2 years now, they have not used human waste in their system. Yet they're still producing product, and they're still using it for the benefit of farmers. That's what we were told they were going to do in the beginning. It's nice to see them back where they started. Hopefully, they're able to make money on that and go on.
Let's hope. Thank you.
Thank you. Brian?
Gentlemen, how are we doing? I'm just here to speak on behalf of the Shawnee Road property as well. It's my understanding that house has been vacant for roughly 10 years. Is that correct?
It's been a while, for sure.
So I was just kind of wondering why all of a sudden, is it because there was people there that stirred up the neighborhood to, you know, kind of move this forward, the demolition or what have you? I understand it's private property, but to me, David Holmes agreed to strip off the roofing, abate the asbestos. I mean, that's a lot of work to go through for them to just say, all right, the heck with it, we'll pull them a plug. I'm just kind of wondering if you guys feel the complaints, you know, those kind of should have been turned over to Chris or, you know, someone in the fire department in regards to that. Tell the neighbors, hey, we're here for training. I mean, obviously, we try to provide you guys with the best service possible, and it don't get much better than a live house, to be honest with you. Knock on wood, we don't get a lot of fires in the town, but you know, the guys still need training, still need live fire training. All my guys can walk through either tower blindfolded and know where every room is. When you get a new structure like that, it really teaches the guys, you know, your fundamentals. And I just hope moving forward, if you guys do get complaints on future houses that we have or acquired, make sure you let us know so we can take care of it. Let the neighbors know. Well, I'll go door to door. It don't matter. You know, and explain the situation to the people that, you know, just because we may be upsetting 3-4 neighbors on Shawnee Road, it's really benefiting the whole, you know, town of Wheatfield. And that's what we're trying to do here. That's basically all I got.
I will say, I can't speak for the other gentleman, but I'm not a Facebook fanatic. I don't have a Facebook of my own. I had not heard a complaint. I still haven't heard a complaint. I've only seen Chris's email of explanation. And I've talked to Mike about it. It is a private piece of property, which there's an agreement in place with the homeowner and the building inspector.
Yeah, I understand.
The building inspector has been pushing to have it taken down because it needs to be taken down.
Mm-hmm.
If the private property owner chose to slow that down, would Mike allow it to be slowed down? I guess that's between the two. But once it gets into asbestos,
right,
you don't want to be walking into that building with asbestos.
No, I understand that. But, you know, they seem to put the foot forward and say, here, you guys can have this house. And then now all of a sudden, just because of a little Facebook drama, it all just got flipped upside down. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. Maybe we'll try to discuss with David Holmes if you guys are willing to bend a little bit with the demolition permits.
It has nothing to do with us. It's between Mike and the property owner, the private property owner in this case.
Okay.
Mike has a job to do, and he does it well.
Understandable.
And if the property owner wants to take it down, he has to follow the rules.
Okay. Thank you.
Speaking for myself and probably the rest of the town board, I didn't even know this building was coming down. I don't believe the town board did.
No.
The board members did till I spoke with Mike this morning after talking to some of you guys about it. I don't think the town board even knew the building was coming down.
Okay. So maybe a little transparency would help too. Okay. Thank you.
Follow up on Gil said, until I got here tonight for tonight's meeting, I didn't even know this problem existed.
Understandable.
I mean, it was the first I heard about it was tonight.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Matt. Brian? Okay. Is there anybody who wishes to speak on any subject? If not, then we'll move on. Kathy, for the record, all board members are present. Gentlemen, we do have a set of minutes for May 2nd, 2016. Does somebody wish to move those in for approval? Moved by Larry, second by Art. Anything on the question? Anything anybody wishes to change? If not, then all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? That's approved. We have a bill pay. The bill pay is $367,908.81. Voucher numbers 2016-743 through 871. Does anybody wish to move those in for payment?
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Randy, second by Gil. Any bills that anybody wishes to hold? All in favor of paying these bills signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Any opposed? That's approved. Departments, Paul Sigman. What's going on in Highway? I would assume it's quite a bit. I would assume it's quite a bit. We'll probably bring that up when we get to the motion again.
As far as the shipping goes, when we're putting the last 2 months of meeting, we don't ship the day before garbage anymore. We start one section of town and we get 14 in town. It's actually working out fantastic. We've got a town shipped every week. And a lot of times we got Friday to start another job and something else. So that's just freed up to do another week. If there are any questions, if there's problems, I know I still haven't heard that the shipping is done the way it was before. Being done to start one place to the center. Where you have gotten around, tell them, go on the website, you can send it in there. We have copies in the first office of the printing machine, so if you have any questions, you can call me.
Anybody got anything for Paul? Rich Donner, Water and Sewer. Rich, we were asked at the sewer board meeting at the last meeting, that's now a couple of weeks ago, to try and get the INI jobs in. Are you working towards an INI job? Well, last year was about as late as you can get. Okay. Anything for Rich? Mike Rinelli, Recreation.
A couple of things tonight. Presently, we have 9 days open out of 44 possible days for summer camp registrations. When I say open, I have like 2 or 3 per day, and there's a waiting list for every other day. We take 60. Most days we have upwards to 70. So Most of those days are Tuesdays, which is a swim day and a field trip day, which is odd. Usually those are the ones that fill up first, but for some reason, those are the ones that are going to be last this year.
And that's for ages 5 through 12, 12. Maybe 13.
Yep. Some 4-year-olds that are going to turn 5 during the season, but yeah, 5 to 12. And then we're going to have our last middle school dance the 27th at the youth center, 8 to 10 p.m., and just the motions I have for tonight. You know, you just want to wait for that. Or
anybody have anything for Mike? Thank you, Mike. Mike Clark, anything else? No. Bridget's not going to be able to be here tonight, but Arlene is. Which tournament? Bocce? And we're holding it here? Excellent. They asked me to play, but I knew better. Didn't want to get embarrassed. June 2nd, is that the same day as the, that's Thursday, what's the fishing day? Late June? Yeah. Very good. Tim Zuber, anything from Wendell?
Thank you. We do have a couple things this evening. The first of which is our planning board summary. This covers the last two meetings of the planning board, which was April 20th and May 4th. Not a whole lot at those meetings. On the April 20th meeting, there was a public hearing for a temporary special use permit for Schur, Mr. Schur. The public hearing was held with regards to their 8th renewal of a temporary special use permit to stable 3 horses at 3990 Hill Road. There are no complaints on file, and there were no objections towards the proposed action. The planning board subsequently approved another 2-year temporary special use permit with noted conditions that will expire on April 4th of 2018. That was it for the April 20th meeting. On the May 4th meeting, there was a site plan for the Niagara International Sports and Entertainment Facility. We've talked about this one a couple times before, but the applicant again proposes to construct 2 96,000 square foot air-supported structures for multi-purpose sports fields on the east side of the Summit Park Mall. The 2 domes will be 75 foot high and will be connected to the main mall through a small structure. The applicant received a height variance from the ZBA, conditioned upon approval from the FAA. The applicant has also agreed to all fire advisory board comments. A negative declaration under SEAKER was issued at the April 6th meeting, and the site plan was approved with noted conditions of the planning board and contingent upon engineering review. So that is the brief summary of our last 2 planning board meetings. Any questions on those? Okay. Our only other agenda item this evening, after just discussion a few minutes ago with Paul Sigmund, we are respectfully withdrawing. So we have nothing else for you this evening.
Okay. I guess we'll go to regular motions, Matt.
Before I get into motions, there is on my attorney agenda proposed bringing the board's attention discussion regarding the ash borer effect on trees within the town of Wheatfield. I did prepare a memorandum to the town whether board members, if a study is something that the board would consider. There's no motion with regard to it, but this may be an upcoming expense that the town may incur with regard to diseased or dead trees. We've had word from the county health department that the majority of, if not all of the ash trees will most likely perish as a result of the ash borer. So that item, I don't know how much of a discussion the board would like to have at this point, but it's something if the board would like to go forward with, I certainly in future upcoming meetings can prepare an agenda item.
It is something that's going to hit us whether we want it to hit us or not. Our problem right now is we don't know how hard it's going to hit. Whether it's $50,000 to tear down trees or whether it's $500,000, we just don't know. That's also important for residents. There is one company who claims that they can save the trees. You have to service the trees every 2 years. But by servicing the trees, they have a spray that they put into the tree. They literally plunge it into the tree, that they can save ash trees. So if you have one in your yard and you'd like to save it, I do have a name. I will be meeting with the gentleman this week, so I'll be able to have somebody available to call. I do believe that Wendell had said that if necessary, they are ready to do a survey as well. I hate to deal in the dark. I'd like to get it done, but it's up to the board, not up to just me. Whether we make a motion this week or 2 weeks from now probably doesn't make a whole lot of difference because the damage is probably half done already. But there are trees that we can save for $150 a year. $150 every 2 years, you can save a tree that might cost $2,000 or $3,000 to take down. So it's not necessarily a bad thing. But you have to know it's out there. Thank you.
Okay, then, moving on to the motions I have. First motion from Highway Superintendent to approve and authorize the town supervisor and councilman to sign the 2016 Highway Law Section 284 agreement for the expenditure of highway monies within the town of Wheatfield as presented at tonight's meeting, May 16, 2016.
First one was just done. I believe. First one was just done. The one was done by Wendell.
I'll second it.
Okay, moved by Larry, second by Art.
Yeah.
I heard Art.
Oh, okay, sorry.
I do have questions. Does anybody else have a question before me? That's what's budgeted this year. That's the entire budget. The interesting thing about that, Paul, is you have help me if I'm wrong with the number, $197,000 on undesignated at this point?
Which covers everything else you do, right, and forward, except for paper and messing in, talked about on the road.
Yep.
There's a couple of lines.
Do you want us, if we see something or hear something from somebody, to bring it to your attention, or do you would you rather not hear from us?
Well, I know everybody wants to roll the last and smooth, but I just feel like we have a really legitimate problem out there. Calling out for us, you know, I think the amendment is later on during the course of the season, the two projects, I don't know what it's going to take us off yet.
Of course.
So I want to leave myself a little cushion. If I have enough over there, if you have to roll it off the back.
I was asking again about Bear Road, and I know you want to do some culvert work there, but I'm just throwing it out there if you have money left over.
Okay.
Well, wasn't part of – no, it was Raymond Road you had in there, right?
Yeah. Raymond Road, yep. The one end of the chair was Gabriel.
Yeah.
It's a serious thing that we told – when we do our education, I have an idea, and we got to do it, we take things with us. And last year, I had money left over my budget.
That road was chip sealed 4 or 5 years ago, right? That didn't hold up? Okay, anybody else on the 284 agreement? If not, then all in favor of approval signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? That is approved.
Next motion, again from the Highway Superintendent, to accept and authorize the Highway Department's drainage improvement and repair project between Millville and Hoover Road, subject to affected residents paying for pipe and materials in the form of an estimated retainer be paid in full prior to commencement of the work.
I'll make that motion if we call it Millville Circle, please.
Smithville Circle and Hoover Run. Okay, so I have a motion and a second. This is basically maintenance work. This is something that existed before and it needs to be repaired, but it's on private property. Okay. Anything on the question? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? That's approved.
Next motion again from the Highway Superintendent to accept an authorized purchase of an Old Dominion Brush Co. Inc. leaf collector. So the leaf collector being a trailer mounted vacuum debris collector model SCL 800 TM14 pursuant to the NJPA award contract number 060612-ODB at a total cost of $39,621 to be paid from the Highway Department's 2016 budget. Said purchase from said NJPA award contract number 060612-ODB avoids the need for the town to conduct its own formal bidding process.
I'll go ahead and make the motion with a comment. I'd like to put a note in there subject to approval by Ed Mongold. Let him have a chance to take a look at the contract to make sure it's a legit contract.
I'll second it.
Second by Gil. Anything further on the question? Go ahead. No, I understand and I can appreciate that point. So this the truck, is that, how do they, it goes from side to side, is that how it picks up rather than out front?
Right, it's out on the right side of it, the guy walks along the hose. It's not as fast as the truck body one, but I think they just
don't. Anything further? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? That's approved.
Next motion from the Recreation Department to authorize the Recreation Department to purchase a new 4x2 gator off the New York State contract at a price of $6,537.05. Said gator is to be a new addition to the fleet, and said purchase will be paid out of the Recreation Department's 2016 budget.
On the question? We have no motion. Do you still want a question? No. I'll wait till you have your motion. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Moved by Gil. Do we have a second?
I'll second on the question.
Go ahead. Is this to replace another gator? So you don't have one to trade in? How is this one here? You got room back there? Okay. Think anything further? If not, then all in favor of purchasing this gator?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? That's approved.
Next motion again from the Recreation Department to approve the Recreation Department purchase of an attachment for the Smithco machine for grooming ball fields at a price of $2,460. Said purchase is to be paid from the Recreation Department's 2016 budget.
Need a second?
I'll second.
Second by Randy. Anything on the question? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? That's approved.
Next motion from the Recreation Department, Highway Department, to authorize crack sealing and slurry sealing to be done at Town Hall parking lot. The estimated costs are $2,870 for the crack sealing and $8,789.15 for the slurry seal, for a total of $11,659.15.
Need a motion?
make the motion.
Need a second.
I'll second it on the question.
Go ahead, Gil.
Mike, did we get a price to stripe it too? We really need it. The parking lot around here looks, I mean, the cracks need sealing. It needs sealing, but did we get a price too for striping it? Because I think if we go through all that before it gets dirty and all goofed up, we should have it striped.
I'll give you a number two after the meeting.
On the question? Go ahead. Did we not buy a crack sealer?
We have a crack
sealer. $25,000?
Yeah, no, I didn't buy a crack sealer.
The highway department has a crack sealer?
About 5 or 6 years ago, right.
Well,
and
how's it running? Anything else in the question? I guess I got one too. What is slurry sealing? Please, somebody.
It's also called bentonite.
So it's a thin coat material. Do you plan on this coming out of that 284 agreement money? For the Rex budget for the town hall?
I am going to run the new laptop, though.
You want to fix those stairs? It's not part of this.
No.
Okay, anything further on the question? If not, then all in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? That's approved.
Next motion, again from the Recreation Department, to authorize a modification of the Fairmount Park Improvement Project to move the pathway from the parking area that is south of the current concrete barriers to the lawn area that is north of the concrete barriers. The cost of this proposed job modification has been quoted by the contractor. $7,416.50.
Okay, does anybody wish to make this motion?
I'll make the motion. May I have a question on it?
And let's see if we have a second first.
I'll second it.
Okay, motion moved and seconded. Go ahead.
I read a little bit on this, Mike. They're going to shift it over to a grass area on the other side of those bollards on the front of our C lot. Are you comfortable with the unit prices that total up to this lump sum? The unit prices in the contract? And you're comfortable with the... Okay, and you're comfortable with this price based upon numbers? Okay.
I went over there with Mike, and Neil Klecki was there laying out our new paths that we're going to have put in. And the paths the engineer that did the work for us laid out were right in the parking lot along the road, which to me, why would you want a path in the middle of the parking lot? That's where the cars parked during the baseball game. I think Mike's doing the right thing, moving it back onto the grass there.
It's certainly
It'll be
safe.
A heck of a lot safer.
Certainly safer, yeah.
I had one question. This is under a grant, too. So will this extra change order be funded by the grant? I don't know if Ed has an answer to that.
Was this an engineering error? And we have to pay for it. I mean, they get paid X amount of dollars for doing the design here, and now GDH gets away with, there's somebody else, there's another outfit.
Hatchmont.
Yeah, I forget the second name.
If we want to take time to review that, we can do so. It will slow down the project by at least 2 weeks if we do that. Mike and I both think that it was a mistake. We don't know if we can approve it. I'm sorry, we both think that it was the engineer missed part of our conversation because we think that it was supposed to be inside the fence.
Right.
He designed it outside the fence.
Yep.
It was sent in to whatever the young Nicole, whatever her name is, from Noel, it's it, from the state and approved by them. And it was not caught here. It is what it is.
Does Noel have to approve this today?
Probably. Okay, anything else, guys? All in favor of approving this change?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Aye.
So 4-1. Okay, Matt, we have additional resolutions.
Yes, the first additional resolution, I will save everyone from reading it, but it is the one with regard to the approving local law number 2. Entitled Amendment to the Code of the Town of Wheatfield placing a 6-month moratorium on ground mounted solar panel and solar farm installations with the town. So this is with regard to the public hearing we had tonight, if the board wishes to act on it tonight, enacting that 6-month moratorium on the ground mounted solar panel and solar farm installations.
Okay. Does anybody want to make the motion for the moratorium? To proceed with the moratorium. So moved. Moved by Art. Do we have a second?
I'll second. And with the comment, I believe that this is why we want to give our group time to look at it. So I think it's a good idea.
Well, everybody will have an opportunity. It can go back through multiple groups within the focus groups. One focus group is going to be charged probably with coming up with a law. Everybody on the task force will have an opportunity to see it before it comes through the planning board. Planning board will have a chance to make change, and then it will come to the town. And we want to get all that done within the 6-month period so that by next spring we know where we're going. It will stop larger collection systems this year, but I don't know how many of those would have been eligible anyway because they're just simply not available under our law in an agricultural zone. Anything else on the question? All in favor of the moratorium signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? That's approved.
Okay, and the last additional motion I had prepared is with regard to the issue that Paul brought up about the Walmer Road Bridge. So it's a motion to proceed with emergency rehabilitation repairs to the Walmer Road Bridge due to a failure of part of the bridge headwall resulting in the closing of the crossing down to one lane. So it's to keep traffic in the center away from the edges where the failure occurred. And whereas this rehabilitation project is required by virtue of a public emergency arising out of an unforeseen occurrence of the headwall failure, the town of Wheatfield does not have to comply with the competitive bidding requirements pursuant to General Municipal Law Section 103, Subdivision 4. And whereas said headwall failure is in a location which is not easily accessible to detour, and said bridge is located in a highly traveled area of the general public, and whereas the immediate repair of the bridge is necessary for the health, safety, and welfare of the general public, and whereas without immediate repairs and rehabilitation, said bridge will deteriorate quickly, rendering it unrepairable and dangerous to public travel. Now, therefore, be it reserved to authorize the town of Wheatfield to begin and complete the immediate repair and rehabilitation of the Walmore Road Bridge and to contract for labor and materials at terms seen fit by the town without the need compliance with competitive bidding requirements, as this rehabilitation project is required by virtue of public emergency pursuant to General Municipal Law, Section 103, Subdivision 4.
I'll go ahead and make this motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second by Art. Paul, you said you had some comments on cost. Is that other bridge in our character as well?
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
okay.
To be honest with you, the pipe on this bridge wasn't horrible. That's why it wasn't one of my first students on the place. You either have all the bad, get hit by cars. The barricades and all that are into the headwall. And the car hits it, we get up the headwall. But obviously, the part of the headwall is getting away. What we're going to do is slip line it, bend it, pull, hopefully 5 to 10 feet on both sides. Put a hole in the top, the floor will fill in there, with 1 to 2 foot rock or drip wrap on both sides, hoping that's going to alleviate our problem. I all have numbers for you guys right now. If I go to 46 foot line, about $26,000. Labor is 10 to 15 grand to hire out, 10 to 15 grand to carry. Ballpark, so you have an idea what it's going to cost.
Is slip lining at that location going to create a restriction? That's a pretty active creek.
Well, in talking with the Army Corps engineers, I told them there's 2.5 feet of silt already on the bottom of that bridge.
That'll come out.
I explained to him what I wanted to do, and he actually just brought like right off of the form, so he just found it okay. He may have
Did you say the total cost you anticipate at $46,000? Is that going to be elongated like the other one is?
Yeah. They go a little shorter, but if you go to 40 foot, they have to put two pipes of welding together. The longest pipe they can get is 25. 25 foot is not going to be enough for that area.
Mm-hmm.
We get a lot of traffic in that area. When we talk about rebuilding the headwall, I can't see so much traffic there that rebuilding and putting on cement trucks. It's not just them, in all fairness. This bridge is probably made in 50. I'm guessing, I don't know, I wasn't around. But they're all about the same age. And I don't know, was the concrete company there when that bridge was put in? I'm sure it wasn't designed for that type of traffic as far as the wood goes. So it actually held up pretty good for all these years.
Well, these heavy concrete trucks coming across that thing every day can't help.
But actually, they worked very well with it. They come to the other side of the bridge, I don't know if you stopped to look at it, and you can make some concrete there.
Yep.
We had a blowout. You brought a concrete truck over to me right away, and you dumped the concrete down and you can hold that wall up for it.
Will a slip line last with that kind of load on it?
I think so. Two grams can be full of stone there. I think it will. Will it last as long as box covers? I probably not. But I think it's probably 30 years, 20, 30 years, if I don't know anything after that. I think we have only used one of those places in town like that. That's the one I'm full of.
We know the DOT's been doing a lot of this on their
road.
It's not
economical the way to do it, like I said. If you put a plan for it, would I want the box culvert? Yes.
Anything else on, I guess I got a question for Ed. Would we be able to put this into that same bond? Cannot go in the same bond because it's specifically named Lemke and Eric Burbridge. Yes, of course. Okay. Anything further on the question? If not, then all in favor of repairing this bridge on an emergency basis, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Are there any opposed? That is approved.
I have no further motions.
Okay. We'll move on to board member items. Councilman Helwig, anything?
Cub Scouts Pack 833 had a successful cleanup on May 7th, thanks to the scouts and all the helpers that were there, and Supervisor Cliff for bringing donuts. And second thing, Supervisor Cliff showed me a letter from Time Warner Cable for our franchise fees for the first quarter, about $56,000. It looks like we're going to be coming in maybe $15,000 over budget if they keep on that pace, right, Ed? So that was good. At least we're getting a little bit more than we anticipated in the budget. That's all I have.
Councilman Gerbeck.
Yeah, I just have one announcement. I want to thank Richard Muscatello for his activity as our facilitator on the Veterans Memorial Group. He's been extremely busy and buried by a number of subcommittees. He's a very involved fellow here and a very valuable asset to all of us. But it's getting to be a bit much. It's starting to back him up. So he wanted to remain on our committee. So we talked it over in the group, and we decided to appoint Ed Sturgeon as our facilitator of the Veterans Group. Ed has probably 6 or 8 years invested in working with the Veteran Memorial Group. So I just wanted to make you all aware. And I want to thank Richard for his very active service that he gave to the Veterans Group.
Okay. Is that it, Art? Councilman Doucette.
I have some correspondence from Adams Fire Hall. They'd like to take Nicholas DiCarlo and make him an active member, and change Jim Mahako from active to exempt, and Joseph Kogel from exempt to active, and I'll make that motion.
Okay, give me a second. Second by Larry. Anything on the question? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? That's approved. Is that it, Gil?
That's it.
Randy?
May 31st, Tuesday night, we're having our next agricultural focus group meeting. That's all. 7 p.m.
Right after a holiday. Huh?
Yep. Back to work.
Okay, we do have an airport overlay proposal coming again out of the task force. Again, a lot of work done by Richard Muscatello on the airport overlay, as well as Drew Riley. And they're asking us to have a public hearing on this issue so that we can hopefully move this ahead. Does anybody wish to pick a date for the public hearing? We could do it at the next meeting, I think, right, Kathy? Could be the June 6th meeting? June 6th. Yeah, does anybody want to do a motion for a time on June 6th? Okay, it is an airport overlay. It doesn't affect all that many residences, but it does affect a lot of landowners. And we may want to do some mailings there. What time, Art, 7:15 good? Okay, 7 o'clock on the 6th of June. There's a lot going on.
think June 2nd is the public information meeting on the Boulevard. The other thing I'd like to briefly talk about is mosquitoes. We did put it out in public. We sent out to the Tribune and to the other newspapers the opinion of me. It's my wording, but the whole town board agrees with the issue on not spraying for mosquitoes. I have talked to Dan Stapleton about that, who is in charge of Niagara County Department of Health, and he concurs completely with what's stated in the letter, that if the state comes along and wants us to do more because they think there's a health hazard, that not only will we be involved, but the county will be involved and the state will be involved. At this point, it's still not indicated to spray for mosquitoes. In his opinion, and in everything you read, it's very limited as to what problem we will see this far north. There is a mosquito in Long Island around the New York City area that could carry the Zika virus. There was encephalitis in New York State for several years around Syracuse last year, or maybe it was the year before last year down in the southern tier, but it's still not indicated up in this area. It's still a health problem, but not a health hazard at this point. So as of right now, we do not intend to spray individual homes. There are some services out there you can work with. You can do the work yourself by purchasing product yourself and do your own yard. But spraying from the sky is not indicated. And that's all I have. We never got to a motion on the public hearing. Okay, do we... Didn't that make a motion? We didn't finish it? Okay. Sorry, thank you. So 7 o'clock on June 6th, Art's motion, if he doesn't have a second, I'll go ahead and second. A public hearing on the airport overlay district. Anything on the question? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, that's approved. I'll have to get all of it. Next meeting will then be June 6th. We'll have the preliminary meeting at 7 o'clock. And then 7:30 for our regular town board meeting. We are back to public input. Does anybody have anything they would like to say? Julie? One on Hoover Road that's pretty good signs.
got two questions. One to Richie. When someone knocks out a fire hydrant, if we get the license plate and the accident report, does their insurance usually cover that? Okay, now a question for Paul. You know where I'm going. You said that cars, you get accidents on those head walls. If we can come up with the vehicles that hit those head walls, and the sheriffs probably have records, I don't know what the statute of limitations, I got a third question, and our town attorney, but can we go after these cars for monetary damage, of taking out these head walls and basically weakening them and putting them in this predicament, or no? I don't know if it was a recent car accident or a recent... Is it just one side or both sides?
Just actually one side. Well, no, both sides are left out. But the one side really is like that's one that's actually
in the... I sent around a picture to the board members so they could see it, but until you look 10 feet away from it and looking at it, you can't believe that's happening. The edge of the pavement is actually starting to crumble in.
So the recourse of going after car insurance is probably not likely, Matt?
Well, generally, if there is a car accident, whether it be, like, for instance, a fire hydrant or something, if there's some damage to the property, a claim should be put in. At this point, if it was an accident from a year and a half ago, although the statute of limitations is up, is not necessarily up, that the issue as far as at least the insurance company taking care of it, they'll probably deny claim because they weren't timely notified. It's something that if there is damage, we should get it in quickly. However, also the expense of this, most insurance policies nowadays, people have a liability, if you have the lower end, the state is only $10,000, which might be enough to cover a fire hydrant to get repaired or replaced, but a head wall, I can imagine, based on the cost we're talking about, could be considerably more. So you can go after the insurance company up to the limits of the insurance. After that, you're going after the driver, which may be difficult and perhaps judgment-proof. But certainly any damage, whether it's a fire hydrant, a mailbox, a guardrail, if it's damaged, we should be seeking some sort of reimbursement, requesting it from the insurance company.
We're still in public input. Does anybody have anything they'd like to say? If not, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn. Moved by Art, second by Larry. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.